experience located at 5708 Howard Foss Drive in the beautiful city of Savannah, Georgia, where our founder and pastor is District John P. Anderson, and our First Lady is First Lady Sister Sally Anderson. We would like to thank you for joining in with us today and to let you know that we really appreciate your presence because, as stated often, there are many other places you can be and many other people you can be listening to, but you decided to join us today, and for that, we are glad and we are thankful. We also want it to be our endeavor, or it is our endeavor, to give you the Word of God as God's Word states it. So we're about to go into our Sunday school lesson on today, and we want to be current, we want to be up to date, and we want to give you the best inspiration, information, God's Word, that is absolutely possible. In Jesus' name, we thank God for your presence. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and mercy. Lord, we thank you for this audience that we have today. God, we ask you to reach out and to touch somebody's heart, oh God. Let somebody feel your presence on today, Lord. We ask you to heal sick bodies, oh God. We ask you to save souls. And Lord, we ask you to convict hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength, my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And with that being said, we're going to go on into our Sunday school lesson today. And today we're going to talk about fasting. And we're going to do that because this is actually that season. And in my life, I really want to give God the type of fast that is acceptable to him. Not just not eat, but to fast. There are certain things Jesus said that these kind goeth not but by prayer and fasting. And we know and understand that fasting adds power to your prayers. That fasting is like that extra step that you're going, and God will honor our fast if we give him what's acceptable to him, in Jesus' name. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy first, the fourth chapter, beginning at verse number 2, because we want to lay some groundwork here first to let you know that what we're going to convey to you today is coming straight from the Word of God, and I'm going to try to keep my opinions out of it as much as possible, as much as I can, as much as I will. Keep mine out and just stick with God's word. So when we stick with God's word, we know that what we're saying is true because God's word is truth. So Deuteronomy 4:2 states, "Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandment of the Lord your God, which I command you." That was from King James Version, and often I vacillate between the King James Version and the Complete Jewish Bible, because the Complete Jewish Bible I find to be, I don't know if it was easier to understand, but it's more direct. It's more direct. It's not using King James English. But that same verse in the Complete Jewish Study Bible says, "In order to obey my commandments," or "in order to obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I am giving you, do not add to what I am saying, and do not subtract from it." See, it's less wordy and it's more direct. Revelations chapter 22, verses 18 and 19, King James says, "For I testify to every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book," and this is talking about the word of God, "if any man should add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. If any man shall take away from these words of the book of this prophecy, God should take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book." Very good. But these same two verses in the Complete Jewish Study Bible says, "I warn everyone hearing the words of the prophecy of the book that if anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues written in this book. And if anyone takes away anything from the words of this book of this prophecy, God will take away his share in the tree of life in the holy city as described in this book." Okay? So the reason why I read those scriptures is to let you know the importance of us getting what God said. Not our paraphrase of it, not our interpretation of it, but getting a direct translation of what the Word of God actually says. And I would like to do this because fasting is so important. So we really need to know exactly what God says about fasting. Okay? And that's what we're going to do today. So fasting is basically not eating. Abstinence from food, water, or something that you really love to do. But an acceptable fast is something a little bit different. Okay? An acceptable fast, fasting acceptably unto God, is far more than not eating or modifying your eating habits. fasting unto God is more than just saying no to sugar, caffeine, TV, social media, meat, shellfish, etc. Not eating while stashing away food and waiting for the clock to run out is not an acceptable fast. Not eating with a side note of just shedding a few pounds that's going to go along with it, that's not an acceptable fast, okay? Because an acceptable fast unto God means you are 100% in. The only reason why you're doing it is because you want greater commune with, you want to greatly commune with God. It's not about losing weight. It's not even, you're not even thinking about health benefits at this particular time. You are just fasting because you want direct contact. You want direct communication, communion with God. Fasting unto God is a sacrifice, and it has purpose. Fasting unto God involves not just your digestive system, but it also involves your body, soul, and spirit. Fasting denies the lust of your eye, flesh, and the pride of life so that the spirit can have and accomplish not what God desires you to accomplish, not what God wants for you to accomplish, but what God commands that we accomplish. The purpose of fasting is not merely to get what you want from God. It is so that God can get what he demands from us. So that's something I think we really need to think about whenever we go on a fast, is the fact that fasting is not so you can get what you want from God. It's not to push God in a corner and say, God, because I'm fasting, I want you to do A, B, and C. Fasting is literally bringing our bodies, bringing our appetites under subjection, okay? Bringing our desires under subjection so that we are more sensitive to what God is saying and what God is doing. Fasting goes hand in hand with presenting oneself before God. And we're going to verify all of this, which I'm saying, but it goes hand in hand with presenting oneself before God and coming into God's presence. When someone or something is presented to a greater or to a greater purpose, to a greater cause, to a greater being, to a greater one, that the mere fact that is presented means that the greater one that it is presented to has the option of accepting or rejecting, okay? And we can't think that just because we don't eat for 24 hours, God is just accepting it. We have to do things God's way, and we're going to talk about doing things God's way. Now, if your offering or your sacrifice or if your fast is acceptable, then God will accept it. If it's not acceptable, you just didn't eat. Let's examine a few scriptures, okay? So one of the purposes of fasting that we find in the Bible is to humble oneself. We will find that we're going to go Old Testament, New Testament. So let's go Old Testament, Book of Ezra, chapter 8. Okay, so Ezra chapter 8. And we're going to start at verse number 21. Ezra 8:21. Then there at the Ahava River, I proclaimed a fast so that we could humble ourselves before our God and ask for a safe journey for ourselves, our little ones, and all of our possessions. Verse number 22, for I would have been ashamed to ask the king for a detachment of soldiers and horsemen to protect us from the enemy along the road, since we had said to the king, the hand of the Lord our God is on us, on all who will seek him for good, but his power and fear is against all that abandon him. So we fasted and asked our God for this, and he answered our prayer. Okay? So, first thing we see in this verse is, this is Ezra, and Ezra had made a petition before the king. Well, Ezra was going back to help build the walls of whatever of Jerusalem. Okay? So, Ezra, knowing that there were that they were the people of God, and they had already made the claims that our God is with us, our God is going to protect us, yada, yada, Ezra knew that there were dangers that they were going to encounter, and which they did. And so Ezra called a fast. But when Ezra called the fast, the first thing he said was, we humbled ourselves. So from this, I gather that when we go on a fast, or when we fast before the Lord, there has to be a change in our attitude. We must humble ourselves, okay? Humble ourselves means we must submit ourselves before God, submit ourselves to God. So he said we humbled ourselves, and they prayed not for cars and houses and land or whatever, not for that, but they prayed for God's protection. Now, remember as we studied in lessons before, that whatsoever we ask God, if it be in his will, we know that we have it, because we do those things that are pleasing in his sight. When we fast and pray, we're going to ask God for what is in his will. That's why it's important to be sensitive to God's spirit, so we can ask him those things that are in his will. Now remember, God is not obliged to give you what's not in his will. But he is obliged to give you what's in his will. He is obliged to fulfill his word. That's where his obligation is, to fulfill his word. So as they prayed for God's protection, because it is God's will, or was God's will, to protect his people. And he said, and God answered our prayer. So from there, let's go to the book of Nehemiah, chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4, we're going to begin reading at verse number 1. And today, as I stated, we are talking about fasting. Okay. Let's see. Let's start at 4. Let's see. Okay. Nehemiah 4, verses 1 through 10. Okay, that's not the one I want. I'm sorry, Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 4. That's the one, I'm sorry. Nehemiah 1, verse 4. On hearing this answer, I sat down and wept. I mourned for several days, fasting and praying before the God of heaven. I said, please, Lord, God of heaven, you great and fearsome God, and I'm reading from the Complete Jewish Bible, okay, who keeps covenant and extends his grace to those who love him and observe his commandments. Okay, so once again, he's praying, he's fasting, but within his fasting, he has humbled himself. He is asking God for something that is according to God's will. He said, let your ear now be attentive and your eyes be open so that you will listen to the prayer of your servant, which I am praying before you these days, day and night for the people of Israel, your servant, even as I confess the sins of the people of Israel that we have committed against you. Yes, I and my father's house have sinned. We have deeply offended you. Okay, so let's take a look at this. We see where he humbled himself, okay? They're praying according to God's will, and also he's making confession. Now, let me throw this in. Confession is not saying, God, if I did anything to offend you. That's like apologizing to somebody and saying, if I did something to hurt your feelings, I'm sorry. That's not an apology. And saying, God, if I did anything to offend you, that's not confession. Because you're not confessing that you actually did anything, or you're not acknowledging that you did anything. So what Nehemiah did was he began to say what it was. Lord, we've offended you. Not if we offended you, we have. Let's see it again. Confess the sins of the people of Israel that we have committed against you. Yes, I and my father's house have sinned. Not, Lord, if I sin, we have sinned. We have deeply offended you. We haven't observed your commandments, laws, or rulings you ordered your servant Moses. Now, check this out. He's saying what they did. Remember, confession is not if I did something. Confession is you let it rip. You say what it is. God, I offended you. I know I offended you. How did I offend you? I did not keep your commandments. I did not keep your laws. Remember, if we confess our sins, God is faithful to forgive. But if you say, God, if I do, you ain't confessed nothing, so you haven't been forgiven anything. Yeah. Okay. Remember, please, the word that you gave through your servant Moses. If you break faith, I will scatter your people. Now, this is what you told Moses. If we broke faith with you, you're going to scatter the people. But if you return to me, okay, and observe my commandments and obey them, then even I will, even your ones that were scattered in the most distant parts of the heaven, I will collect them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen for bearing my name. Okay, so what Nehemiah is saying, that he has confessed the faults or the sins of the children of Israel before God. He's praying, he's fasting, he's confessing. He's not saying, Lord, gimme, 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 I want, I want, I want, I want. He's confessing. He's humbled himself. He's fasting. All of this goes together, okay? And he brings God's word back to the forefront. God, we've sinned, and you told us that if we turn from you, you told us what you was going to do. But God, you also told us, he's bringing God's word back up to him. God, but you also told us that if we return to you, you're going to return to us. And although you scattered us, you're going to bring us back together. He's praying God's will. All right. So from there, let's go to Joel, the second chapter. The book of Joel, the second chapter. And sometimes in my Jewish Bible, because it's set up different from King James, I have to kind of really, the books of the Bible are arranged in a different order than they are in King James. Because in your Jewish Bible, the last book of the Old Testament is 2 Chronicles. In King James, we know that it's Malachi. So this is going to be Joel. Here we go. But it's a very good Bible. It is very good. So we go to Joel. Let's go to, let's do 1 and 14. Let's see what that says. Okay, let's go to 1 and 14. And then we're going to go to 2 and 15. So 1 and 14 says that we're still talking about fasting. Joel is prophesying about the judgments of God. He's prophesying. And when Joel gets to verse number 14, because calamity is about to come on the children of Israel, because once again, they departed from God's commandment. And judgment was coming. So Joel says, proclaim a holy fast, call for a solemn assembly, gather the leaders, all who live in the land, to the house of the Lord your God, and cry out unto the Lord. Okay? So he's telling them, and the reason why they're doing this is because they want to escape the destruction to come. Now, Joel chapter 2, verse number 15 says, oh, wow, okay. Wow, okay. All right, so here we go. Joel chapter number 15, we're going to start at verse number 12, okay? And once again, Joel is calling for a holy assembly. He's calling for a fast because the nation is in trouble. Does that strike a chord with you? The nation is in trouble. Saints of God, people of God, we are not fasting for our own personal benefit. God, I'm fasting so I can love you more. No. You love God not because God makes you love him. You know, I used to pray that prayer a long time ago. Lord, help me to love you more. It ain't going to happen because that's something that has to come from your heart. God is not going to make you love him. Love is a voluntary act. That's something that you have to do. You have to purpose in your heart to love God. God is not going to make you love him, because if he made you love him, you wouldn't do it. Okay, so beginning at verse number 12. Yet even now, the Lord says, turn to me with all your heart, although judgment is coming. And in the prior verses, it talks about the judgments that are coming. He said, turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, weeping, and lamenting. Tear your hearts, not your garments, and turn to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in grace, and willing to change his mind about disaster. Judgment can be coming our way, but if we submit ourselves before God, rend our heart, and not our garments, which don't put up that fake, phony stuff, but rend your heart, God will turn. He will turn. It says, tear your heart, not your garment, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in grace, and willing to change his mind about disaster. Who knows? He may change his mind and leave a blessing behind him. Enough grain offering and drink offering to present to the Lord your God. Blow the shofar in Zion. We will say blow the trumpet. Blow the shofar in Zion, proclaim a holy fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, consecrate the congregation, assemble the leaders, gather the children, even the infants sucking at the breast, and let the bridegroom leave his room and the bridal chamber. Let the priests who serve the Lord stand weeping between the vestibule and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, Lord. Don't expose your heritage to mockery or make them a byword among nations. Why should the people say, where is thy God? Okay? So, this is very, very, very interesting. Once again, fasting is a sacrifice. It's an offering that you're giving up before God. Fasting is accompanied by humbling ourselves. Fasting is accompanied by repentance. Okay? Those are just a few of the things that accompany fasting. Now, another scripture is in the book of Jonah. If we read the book of Jonah, how the Ninevites, when destruction was coming their way, what did the Ninevites do for 3 days? And the Ninevites weren't church people, wasn't saved people. The Ninevites weren't even religious people. But they had sense enough to know. And check this out. When Jonah went to Nineveh, he didn't heal one person. We don't see where he performed one miracle. And I'm pretty sure the whole city didn't see him wash up on shore. But just at the word that Jonah preached, the whole city repented. The king himself got down in sackcloth and ashes. The animals fasted. The king fasted. The children fasted. Everybody fasted. Because they took what Jonah said seriously. And guess what? God turned. He did not destroy the city. Okay? So, let's move on. Fasting is for us to humble ourselves, but there's something else about fasting that we need to think about, and that is the way that we fast. Very interesting. So, let's go to the book of Zechariah, chapter 8. And once again, I'm going to have to turn to my table of contents to see in the Jewish Bible where Zechariah is located. But Zechariah, chapter 8. Guess what? I'm turning right to it. Yes, thank you, Lord. Okay, Zechariah chapter 8. And we're going to begin at verse number 19. And this is about fasting. Okay, so fasting is not fasting was before the law. Okay, fasting, just like tithing, that was before the law. And there's another thing never mind. Let me keep up with this. Zechariah chapter 8. Verse number 19. The Lord of hosts says, the fast days of the 4th, 5th, 7th, and 10th months are to become times of joy, gladness, and cheer for the house of Judah. The children of Israel fasted in the 4th month, the 5th month, the 7th month, and the 10th month. Now, how many days per month? It doesn't say. But we know that those were days of fasting, the 4th, 5th, 7th, and 10th month. Now, God says, and this is what God is saying, that these fasts are to become times of joy, gladness, and cheer for the house of Judah. Therefore, love, truth, and peace. Now, in the King James Version, it's written a little bit differently, and I'm glad for this Jewish version because it really explains it. Now, in the King James Version, it says, fast 4th, 6th, 7th, and 10th month, yada yada, shall be to the house of Judah joy and gladness, cheerful feasts, therefore love, truth, and peace. Okay? Now, when I read it that way, it didn't make much sense because you're talking about fasting and you're talking about feasting too. Didn't make any sense. So when I went to my Jewish study Bible, it breaks it down that the fast in those months are to become times of joy, gladness, and cheer. The word cheerful feast is not there. It says and cheer. So fasting is not a time for you to walk around looking like, you know, as somebody used to say, who done it, what for, and don't do it no more. It's not time for you to go around looking like that. But it's a time of joy. Wow. How can it be a time of joy and you're hungry? When you get in God's presence, in the fullness of the Lord, there is joy. Okay? trying to get into God's favor, we're getting into God's presence. And once we get into God's presence, it's nothing like being in his presence, because in his presence is the fullness of joy. So it's going to be a time of joy. It's going to be a time of gladness and a time of cheer for the house of Judah. Therefore, love, truth, and peace. Now, you can only find joy, cheer, and gladness during fasting if you develop a love for truth and a love for peace. Let's go to the book of Matthew, the 6th chapter. Hold your finger here. Go to the book of Matthew. We're going to spend a lot of time in Matthew and in Isaiah, but hold your finger here. Matthew chapter 6. Okay, Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to begin at verse number 14. Remember what Zechariah said, a time of joy, gladness, cheer. Therefore, love, truth, and peace. Now, Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 says, verse 16, I'm sorry. Now, when you fast, don't go around looking miserable like the hypocrites. They make sour faces so that people would know they are fasting. Okay? Yes, I tell you, they have their reward already. But you, when you fast, wash your face and groom yourself so that no one will know you are fasting except your Father who seeth thee in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward thee. Okay? Now, Zechariah said it's going to be a time of joy, going to be a time of cheerfulness, going to be a time of gladness, love, love, truthfulness, and peace. Jesus teaches his disciples about fasting, okay? And the first thing Jesus tells them is what not to do, what not to look like when you're fasting. Because this is something between us and God, you and God. You are coming into God's presence. You're not going to come into God's presence looking like you're miserable. Let's go from there to, let's do the book of Mark chapter 2. And we've already established that fasting was what took place before the law, during the law, even after what we call the dispensation of law. So, Mark chapter 2, verse 18 says, so, Jesus was asked a question. And the question is, also, John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and they came and asked Jesus, why is it that John's disciples and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples don't fast? Okay? Now, remember, while Jesus was in his earthly ministry, his disciples didn't fast. Why? Because Jesus did it. Because Jesus did it. Jesus said, can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is still with them? He's the bridegroom. So can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, fasting is out of the question. But the time will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and when that day comes, then they will fast. Okay? Now, let's take a look at something else. Let's go to, we have Matthew 6:16. Let's go to Luke 5 and 33. Now, this is telling us that fasting is necessary. You're going to fast. It is necessary. No one has, as people of God, We must fast. We will fast if we want to make it. Okay, so Luke 5:33 says, it's basically reiterating what Mark says. Next, John's disciples are always fasting. Okay, fasting, but yours are not fasting, whatever. And then Jesus says again, can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is still with them? Time is going to come that they shall fast. Okay, now, let's take a look at this. Jesus fasted. Jesus told his disciples what kind of fast they were going to have to fast. The book of Zechariah tells us how we are supposed to look or conduct ourselves when we fast, which correlates with what the book of Matthew says. Okay? Now, let's go to the book of Isaiah 58. answers all, everything we need to know about fasting is in Isaiah 58. Okay, so let me go here. I am learning. I'm getting around in this Jewish Bible a lot quicker than I used to. Hey, good job. Okay, here we go. So, Isaiah 58, we're going to begin at verse number 1, and we're going to take this kind of slowly. Shout out loud, don't hold back, raise your voice like a shofar. Proclaim to my people what rebels they are, and to the house of Jacob their sins. Oh yes, they seek me day after day, and claim to delight in knowing my ways. Now, this scripture is very telling and very interesting, because when we look into the scripture, I guarantee we can find ourselves. So, they seek me day after day and claim to delight in knowing my ways, as if they were an upright nation that had not abandoned the rulings of their God. They ask me for just rulings and claim to take pleasure in closeness to God. That is the situation that a lot of our religious organizations, people, friends are in. We want to say that we are a Christian nation, but we've turned our back on God as a nation. And even within the church, we want to say that we love God. We want to say that we honor God. But in reality, our works don't pan out that way. He's not first. See, one thing about God is either going to be first in your life or he's not going to be there. He does not play second fiddle. He does not take second place and say that, you know, you're gonna slide on into heaven anyway, even though I wasn't first place. No, he doesn't do that. So he says that as if they were an upright nation that had not abandoned the ruling of God. In other words, we pretend or we act as though we say we're a Christian nation and we ask God for his blessings. Lord, bless me, bless me, bless me. God, you know I'm doing this and I'm trying. We try, but we never do anything. Okay? And so he said, you ask for just rulings. You want me to be just with you. You want to go to heaven anyway. And you claim to take pleasure in being close to me and claim to take pleasure in closeness to God, asking. But then you say, why should we fast if you don't hear us? Why should we mortify ourselves if you don't take notice? So if I ask God and don't get what I want when I think God is supposed to deliver it to me, we say, well, why do it? And God said, here is my answer. He says, when you fast, you go about doing whatever you like while keeping your laborers hard at work. Your fast leads to quarreling and fighting, to lashing out with violent blows. On a day like today, fasting like yours will not make your voice heard on high. Now, he asks a question. He says, now, is this the sort of fast I want? Now, he's telling us, I want you to think about this. Is this what I want? Is it a day for you to mortify yourself? Is this the sort of fast I want? A day when a person mortifies himself? Is the object to hang your head like a reed, spread sackcloth and ashes under yourself? Is that what you call a fast? A day that pleases the Lord? So what he's saying here is exactly what Jesus said in Matthew. When you fast, you're not going to have a sad face, hang your face, you know, just have a real sad face and everybody say, well, I'm fasting, I'm so hungry. No, you're not going to do that. He's asking, when you do that, do you think that's acceptable? Now, Zechariah told us that fasting should be a day of what? Of joy and of gladness, as opposed to being sad and hanging your face down like a bulrush. Okay? He said. Then God says, here is the sort of fast I want. Okay? Now, we're going to take this scripture and we're going to relate this to Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 18. Which is what Jesus did, how Jesus fulfilled this. It says, here is the sort of fast I want. Releasing those unjustly bound, untying the thongs of the yoke, letting the oppressed go free, breaking every yoke. Now let's go to Luke, the 4th chapter. And we're going to see exactly what Jesus did. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verse number 18. It's in verse number 18. Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to announce the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the imprisoned." Go back to Isaiah. Unloose those, releasing those unjustly bound. He's proclaiming freedom to the prisoners, untying the thongs of the yoke, letting the oppressed go free, proclaiming freedom for the imprisoned, renewed sight of the blind, to release those who have been crushed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. This is what Jesus did, letting the oppressed go free, untying the yoke, releasing those who were unjustly bound. That's Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Now, he says, he goes on to say this. Not only are you doing this, but sharing your food with the hungry. Remember when Jesus fed the 5,000, the 4,000? And then the Bible lets us know in the book of St. John that Jesus did so many things that even the world can't contain the books that should be written. Did he feed the hungry? Yes, he did. Taking the homeless poor into your house, clothing the naked when you see them, and my God, he did do that. How did he do that? With his righteousness. How did he bring the poor into his house? In my Father's house. A mini mansion. We are of his household. Okay? Fulfilling your duty to your kinsmen. Okay? This is what you do when you fast. So fasting is not just I'm not eating, I'm laying back. You're busy. Then there is something that happens when you do this. God answers your prayer. Listen, it says, then your light shall burst forth like morning. Your new skin will quickly grow over your womb. Your righteousness will precede you, and the glory of the Lord will follow you. This is greater than a car or a house or paying off a bill. This is what happens when we give God an acceptable fast. Your light shall break forth as morning. Didn't Jesus say you are the lights of the world? You are the light of the world? Let that light break forth like morning. New skin will cover your womb. Now, new skin covering your womb, he will heal your hurts. He will heal your hurts. Righteousness will precede you, and the glory of the Lord will follow you. He got you covered going and coming. Then you will cry, and the Lord will answer. Now, you're going to cry to me, and I'm going to say, here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, stop the false accusation and slander. In other words, if you remove what has, you remove your self-inflicted things that have you bound. Remove that yoke. Remove it from other people too. How can you do that? By forgiveness. A lot of people are in bondage because of unforgiveness, okay? If you stop the false accusation and slander, stop gossiping and stop lying. False accusation, you're telling a lie. Slander, you're gossiping, okay? Generously offer your food to the hungry and meet the needs of the person in trouble. Then your light will arise in darkness and your gloom will become like noon. Darkness will become light to you, okay? Remember, generously offer your food to the hungry, okay? Here we go. The Lord will always guide you. So when you stop all of this foolishness, which is in verses number 9 and 10, verse number 11 tells you the effect. The Lord will always guide you. He will satisfy your needs in the desert. He will renew the strength of your limbs so that you will be like a watered garden, like a spring whose water never fails. That's a pretty good payback, isn't it? Verse number 12, you will rebuild the ancient ruins, raise the foundation of past ages, and be called repairers of broken walls, restorers of streets to dwell in. There's a lot that can be said about that. Verse number 13. If you hold back your foot on the Sabbath from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight, the Lord's holy day worth honoring, then honor it by not doing your usual things or pursuing your own interests or speaking about them. This is about putting God first. And there's a whole teaching on the Sabbath that I'm not going to go through right now, but Lord's will, I will. If you do, you will find delight in the Lord. I will make you ride on the high places of the earth, on the heights of the land, and will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the go back and let's take this apart. When we fast, number one, we humble ourselves before God, okay? Number two, we come before God with repentance. We repent. We don't say, God, if I did anything. We say, God, yeah, I did it, and I need you to help me. Lord, I'm asking you to forgive me for not keeping your commandments. Lord, I'm asking you to forgive me for my slander. I'm asking you to forgive me for my gossip. Lord, I'm asking you to forgive me for whatever, I'm not going to say whatever I did. You think about it, they'll come to your mind. And you confess those things. Confessing is not if I did something wrong. Confessing is no, I'm going to say what I did wrong because I know I was wrong. Okay? The Bible says if we confess our faults, he is faithful and just to forgive us. Now, when you are forgiven and he will forgive you, you still fast. But at this point, you know that you are forgiven. Now you're fasting with joy and gladness because of what he's done, because he has forgiven you. Now, remember, the most important gift we could ever give somebody is forgiveness. And that's the most important gift we can give ourselves, too. Why? Because if you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. So when you forgive others, God forgives you. Okay? So we forgive, we rejoice, we're happy. We're happy that we are rejoicing in his forgiveness. Okay? Now, we come before God not in sorrow now, but we come before God in joy. Jesus told us in the book of Matthew that when you fast, he said, anoint your head and wash your face. And there was in the Jewish version, it says that when you fast, we are going to, let me go to it. He used another word. Because anoint doesn't necessarily mean you take a dab of oil and put it on your head. That's what we say. That's not necessarily what anoint means. Okay? To anoint means to smear yourself with oil. Now, he said in Matthew, groom yourself, because you don't want to look like you're fasting. So when you come before God and now you're fasting, you're not going to come looking like sad sack. You're going to groom yourself. You're going to pull it together, okay, with joy and with gladness, and you're going to rejoice in what God is doing. And you're going to start doing what God wants you to do, which is found in the book of Isaiah, chapter 58. Read it over. Read it again. And he tells us the type of fast that he don't want and the type of fast that he wants. And the type of fast that he wants is what we're going to give to him. And when we give God what God commands, God will automatically respond in kind and give us, restore his promises to us. Automatically. So saints, whoever's listening, fasting is not something that you do to say you did it and you got done with it and you got it over with and you made it. No. Fasting is a rather busy time because in fasting, we are making amends. In fasting, we are repenting. In fasting, we are getting it straight. But also in fasting, God is blessing us because as we decrease by not doing our own thing, by not doing our own will, he will begin to increase. He said, then shall your light break forth. Okay? And what light is he talking about? Jesus is the light of the world. He said, now you are light of the world. You are the light, not the lights, but now you are the light of the world. Why are you now light of the world? If his spirit is in you, and if you decrease lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, pride of life, if you can decrease that as you begin to decrease, like John said, he will increase. I must decrease and he must increase. And what we want is we want him to increase, and we want him to increase to the point that as Jesus was, so shall we be in this earth. That's how much we want him to increase in us. We want him to increase so that it can be said of us, now people know that I am his disciple. Because what? We have love one for another, and also because we do the things he did. He said, the things I do shall you do also, but we know that some things you're not going to do except it come by prayer and fasting. Jesus said, while he was here on earth, his disciples didn't fast, but he said, a time is going to come when the bridegroom is going to be taken away, and then shall they fast. Amen? Okay, so that will be our recap for today, that if your church is on a fast, take it seriously. Do what you have to do. Amen? So next thing. guess would be a question is, how exactly do we fast? It's a, do we just give up food? Do we give up food and water? Something like that. I'm going to tell you this way. You have leadership in your church, and what your leadership that God put in place tells you to do, as long as it's according to God's word, do it. Do it. Because let this be known, New Life is not trying to get people to follow us, nor is Sister Scott trying to get anybody to follow her. But what I do want you to start doing is reading your word. Listen to your leadership, but also read your word. Let that word dwell in your heart richly. Amen? Amen. God bless you. I hope that this broadcast has been a blessing to you, because I'm going to tell you, whether it bless you or not, it blessed me, because I learned a lot about fasting just by research. And that's what we all need to do. Be like the Bereans. Research. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Hope you join us again next week. Hope this has been a blessing to you. And we look forward to seeing you next week. God bless you. You have a blessed week.